Welcome to the Baltic University. My name is Lars Rydén. I am a professor of biochemistry and director of the Baltic University program. In 10 televised sessions, we will together discuss the Baltic region and the Baltic Sea environment. This is a model of the Baltic Sea, and we will come back to this model as we go through this first session that will deal with the physical geography of the Baltic. But before we start that, we will show you a short introductory movie that will explain you about the Baltic region.
The Baltic region makes up a large share of Northern Europe, in fact 15% of all Europe. It is the region where all water flows into the Baltic Sea. It forms a single system. However, politically, the region is heterogeneous. 10 countries make up most of it: Sweden, Finland, Russia, Belarus, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Germany, and Denmark. Another 3 contribute smaller parts: Norway, Ukraine, and Czechoslovakia. Culturally and linguistically, the region is rich. The many languages spoken form 4 distinct groups: Germanic, Finnish-Ugric, Baltic, and Slavic. The total population is close to 80 million. The majority lives in the population-dense southern parts. In fact, Poland alone has nearly 40 million inhabitants. Several million-sized cities are found: Krakow, Warsaw, Copenhagen, St. Petersburg, and Stockholm, to mention some of them. The Baltic Sea itself and its neighboring waters form a fifth of the area. In these waters, we will include Kattegat to the west, the Finnish Bay to the east, and the Bothnian Bay in the north. Through several large lakes and important river systems, water flows from surrounding land into the sea. The Baltic Sea is quite special in several ways. It is one of the largest brackish water seas in the world. It was, a few years ago, one of the world's most productive waters, with a yearly fish catch of nearly 1 million tons. Today, we can note a new record. It is one of the world's most polluted seas. The large forests in the north have made possible major paper mill industries. These give rise to serious emissions of industrial pollutants. Mines and heavy industry in southern Poland and Czechoslovakia, as well as on the Estonian coast, are even more polluting. From the rich agricultural areas in the south, excess fertilizers find their way to the sea. Many of the large population centers have no or insufficient sewage treatment. These activities of men threaten the Baltic. The increased amounts of nitrogen and phosphorus cause yearly algal blooms in surface waters. These often cover enormous areas. In some instances, the algae are toxic. They kill fish and threaten ourselves. The excess nutrients also strike against the life forms at bottoms. Large areas of the bottoms in the Baltic proper are today dead. One of the immediate consequences is diminishing cod catches. Industrial emissions, in particular chlorinated organic compounds, accumulate in ecosystems. They strike most heavily against predators. The only large mammals of the Baltic, the seals, are today threatened by extinction. Our largest bird, the sea eagle, is also in danger. Obviously, we should change the situation and clean up our environment. But to do so, we need to understand better what is going on and exactly what to do. Research, education, and investments need to go hand in hand. The course, The Baltic Sea Environment, will describe the situation as it is understood today by scientists from all over the region. It will give a picture from all kinds of disciplines, from geography and biology, chemistry and medicine, law, economy and technology. It will concentrate on problems and how to deal with them. The Baltic region forms an unusually clear example of a so-called eco-geographical region. Environmentally, it forms an indivisible whole. To do something meaningful, we have to do it together. The Baltic University is one such effort to unite our knowledge, teaching and learning capacities and look for a better future together.
As you saw, we are many, in fact, more than 70 universities which take part in this program. More than 3,000 students have registered in 10 countries. These 10 countries have a lot of common history, and we would like to show you some of that common history. This video will cover 8,000 years. It was filmed this summer on Gotland. The film team was from Vytautas Magnus University in Kaunas, Lithuania. Welcome to the heart of the Baltic Sea. This is the island of Gotland, and we are going to start our first session right here.
We're very pleased to welcome you to this beautiful spot because it's significant not only geographically as the heart of the Baltic, but also culturally. Gotland has been inhabited for a very, very long time, and here on this western tip, we are able to show you several Stone Age settlements. If we take a look to my right, we see the beautiful city of Visby that was developed in the 8th century, directly on a Stone Age site. We see the boats in the harbor, we see some churches that have been built by the Germans, and we see, as we continue through the beautiful landscape, the sheltered coves, the bay, the shoreline, a continuation of Stone Age settlements. And amongst them is the one directly in front of you, that is a site that has been known to exist since 3000 BC. Eric?
Yes, down there among the trees, there was a large Stone Age settlement going back to about 2500 years BC. The people here, they lived by the sea. They fished and they hunted seal and they did some agriculture. The sea was their way of life, and the sea also meant communication. Now we are standing in front of a young woman at the age of 20 years old who once upon a time lived on one of those Stone Age settlements.
In order to better understand the significance of the site, we would like to take you back to the studios and show you some digital maps since the ice age of this area.
Life in the Baltic region dates back to times when the area slowly melted out of the last inland ice. From the maximum position some 20,000 years ago, the ice retreated, first slowly, then faster. At the same time, our Stone Age ancestors advanced northwards, hunting reindeer and other animals not far from the ice margin. They often lived by the sea, and their dwellings may be found on the contemporary beach berms. After a short re-advance, between 12 and 10,000 years ago, the ice quickly disappeared. By 8,000 years before present, there was no inland ice left.
We know very little about Bronze Age ships. However, we do have on Gotland 350 burials in the shape of ships, of which you see one of the most excellent sites right here in front of us. Eric?
Yes, these ships have functioned as burials during the Bronze Age. And otherwise, what we know about ships from this time, that are ships found on rock carvings, but they are not in this size. Otherwise, we don't know. But this ship, I think, was very well for the travel of the soul. Well, we are standing at a place called Loista. And behind us, you can see the reconstruction of a house on original place. The reconstruction was done in the 1930s. This house represents a type of buildings that people here on the island lived in, say, from about 200 years AD up to about 500 years AD.
It's very interesting to note that the similar type structures are found throughout the Baltic, to the south, to the east, and to the west. The sun, as the Well, Eric and I are standing right now in the middle of what used to be one of the largest harbors on the eastern part of Gotland. And in English, we would call it Boogie Bay, but in Swedish...
Bogeviken.
Yes. And we are now standing in the middle of the harbor because the water at that time was 2.5 meters higher than it is right now.
You can see now what's coming in. That is where you got the church of Boge. And we have carried out excavations there during this spring season. And among the things that we found there is a little bronze item that also has been found on Birka, quite close to Stockholm, and also one found in Novgorod in Russia.
That you see is a copy of a boat that was single-masted and used by the Vikings on their journeys to the eastern part of the Baltic.
The ships in the Baltic are smaller than those you find out in the Atlantic Ocean, because in the Baltic it was important to be able to go up the rivers and inland if you wanted to go, for instance, to the Black Sea and further on.
We're standing at the north gate and wall of Visby, the medieval city. This is an area that has been occupied since the Stone Age, and in this particular manifestation, it is a center of trade and commerce in the 12th century.
Yes, city of Visby was the leading city of the Hanseatic League up till 1299. It was, so to say, really the melting pot of the cultures up here in the Baltic in those days.
The Baltic became a cartographic unit. The first map was drawn in 1539 by Olaus Magnus, a man of the medieval learned tradition. Already then, the universities in Krakow, Rostock, Greifswald, Copenhagen, and Uppsala had been founded. The map of Andreas Bure, drawn in 1613, was the first to be useful as a chart of navigation for trade and warships in the Baltic Sea. At the end of the 17th century, maps were rather modern by our standards. Science had started to flourish and several new universities had been added. Students often traveled and studied at several of them. Today, 300 years later, a tenfold larger population in the region live a life largely in cities. We are now dependent upon industry, science and technology in a civilization that threatens nature and ourselves.
The Baltic University program is directed from Uppsala and run in cooperation with the Swedish Telecom Radio and the Swedish Space Corporation. We send this session to you directly from Uppsala via the Swedish communications satellite Tele-X. We would like to give you a glimpse of Uppsala and also a presentation of our partners in the project.
Uppsala, just north of Stockholm, is the fourth largest city in Sweden. The cathedral and the castle dominate the cityscape. The Center for Humanities and Social Sciences is one of several centers of the university. The large university hospital houses departments for clinical research and for the training of physicians. Preclinical sciences, biotechnology, and pharmacy are found in the biomedical center. The university has in total some 18,000 students, in addition to its 5,000 teachers, researchers and personnel. Teaching consists of lectures, but laboratory work is important, especially in the programs of physics, chemistry and biology. The tradition of natural sciences has been strong ever since the time of Linnaeus and Celsius, Bergman and Scheele in the 18th century. The Faculty of Natural Sciences is the largest in Sweden. Uppsala University was founded in 1477. Many of its older buildings are still in use. Gustavianum from 1628 is a landmark in the city. The main university building houses teaching and conferences, board meetings and festivities. It is also where the rectorate is situated.
I should also like to extend to all of you a most hearty welcome to this program, and we do hope in Uppsala University, which is, as you may know, one of the oldest in Northern Europe, we hope that this will prove a worthwhile effort and will provide you with a good and a fresh start in our common work for preserving the natural environment of that sea which unites us all, Uppsala, and a great number of old and new friends in the university family around the Baltic. Heartily welcome.
Good afternoon. What you are about to see is the first broadcast in a unique series about and starring the Baltic Sea. You know all this already, of course, because many of you have and will be contributing feature materials, pictures and information. But before the programs, so to speak, land in your television sets, they've passed through a complex process of assembly and distribution. Three companies makes this possible. Swedish Telecom is technically responsible for the broadcast. Together with Swedish Space Corporation, they also make sure that the signal is transmitted from the Tele-X satellite down to your dish. Esping and Felmer Limited masters the actual broadcast as executive producers. Together, these three companies make sure that coherent programs are brought to you out of tons of equipment, in numerous participants and technicians, and dozens of contributions from you. But this is not only a technical feat, even though it is a remarkable event in terms of broadcasting. We all feel the need to contribute to this cause, if not for ourselves, so for you. So now it's high time for me to hand over to your host, Lars Rydén.
We send this program to you from the Linnaeus Garden in Uppsala. Carl Linnaeus, the King of Flowers, became a professor of botany in Uppsala at Uppsala University 250 years ago. And one of the many things he made was to construct this very nice garden. You can see it from the main entrance here, and you have the garden to the left and to the right. In the background, you see the building in which we are right now. It's a orangery or hothouse. This building was necessary for the survival of the plants during the Swedish winter. This is Linnaeus as a young man on the sculpture you can see. Now in the around us here you can see some of the flowers that Linnaeus actually had when he was a botanist here. You have the coffee bush, you have the laurel, and several others. This table here that we have right in front of us and we are sitting with, it's made by Linnaeus. It was used by him actually more than 200 years ago. It was made by a single piece of a populous trunk. Our first undertaking in this session will be to discover the geography of the Baltic region, and our main guide will be Lars Håkansson. Lars is a professor of hydrology at Uppsala University. Welcome, Lars.
Thank you.
And we also have a couple of guests. Dr. Andrzej Kowalczewski is a professor of hydrobiology at the University of Warszawa. Welcome, Andrzej. We also have here Viktor Jonov. Viktor is a professor of oceanology at the University of St. Petersburg. Welcome, Viktor. And also, quite a few of the students who take part in the course in Uppsala are here. And the rest of them are watching through the satellite. Now, we are going to start this discussion by asking ourselves, what is so special about the Baltic? Of course, the Baltic is special to all of us because we live here. But is the Baltic Sea also special for a geographer, Lars?
Well, there are very many reasons why the Baltic is special. First of all, it's a very shallow sea. And the reason for that is that it is an epicontinental sea.
Mm. We will see that on the first map, actually.
Yeah. Mm. And it is a sea with brackish water.
Mm. Yes, and
With cold water. Mm. And it has a very limited water exchange. Here we can see that it is shallow.
You see the light blue color is shallow and the dark blue is very deep water. So the dark blue is between the continents.
That's right. We can see that the Mediterranean is a very deep sea situated between continents. So the Baltic has a limited water exchange and it is sensitive to pollutants. It also have a very high natural bioproductivity.
Yes.
And it is, as you said before, very polluted.
Yes. What about the population? I mean, this is also an area that is quite unusual. Let's have a look at this world map of population density.
Yeah, we can see what we all know, the hotspots where millions of people live close to the oceans. But that is not entirely true for our part of the world. We have 80 million people living in the drainage area of the Baltic, and most of them live in the south.
Yes, yeah, so this is almost the only place on Earth where we have a high density population that is not by an ocean.
Yes.
Well, I believe we have a sort of summary of what you just said here, but let's also ask our guests. Andrzej, what would you like to point out as special about the Baltic Sea?
Well, I would say it is very special because a lot of fresh water is getting into that sea. This fresh water, which obviously comes from the drainage area, brings not only the fresh water, and this we know very well because of the low salinity of the Baltic, but it brings also a lot of pollutants. In fact, Baltic is the last sink for all pollutants which we put into our small sinks in our homes and, of all what is polluting fresh water. That is why we should really take care about not polluting the fresh waters, because in this way we protect the Baltic Sea.
And Victor, do you want to come with the oceanologist's point of view on the Baltic Sea?
Yeah. And another point is that the Baltic can obtain the oxygen-rich salt water from the Atlantic only from time to time, occasionally. And only this way we can to renew, not me, not we, the nature can to renew the bottom layer of the Baltic of water, fresh water, in terms of oxygen condition. It's very important.
This gives us a very good reason to go back to the model and look at this inflow of salty water that Viktor Jonov pointed out is so special for the Baltic Sea. And I believe at the model we have Ulf Erlingsson, who is a researcher at the Department of Physical Geography at Uppsala University. We will soon have him in the camera, I believe. Ulf has prepared all the maps that you have seen, and you will see several more. And he also constructed the data set that was used to make the model that you saw in the beginning, and we will see soon again, I hope. There we are.
Yes.
Hello. Welcome, Ulf.
Thank you. Well, this is the model of the Baltic Sea, which is a true scale model in 1 to 1 million. That's the horizontal scale. It means that 1 centimeter on the model is 10 kilometers in reality. But the vertical scale is very much exaggerated, actually 200 times. 1 centimeter is 50 meters. So the flat surface, which you see here, is actually 50 meters above the sea level. On the model, you can see that this is north. We have Sweden here, Scania, Uppsala is right here. We have Gotland, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Finland. And down here we have Denmark, which is very low. Now we're going to make a small experiment with this model. Here we have salt water of the Kattegat, and we have brackish water in the Baltic Sea. So what happens when we remove these seals here to let these two waters mix? Okay. I also start a pump to have some water filled up here. Now, since this water is heavier, it will slowly, slowly flow under the brackish water and enter the great belt between the two Danish islands here. Let's just wait and see what happens here.
You can perhaps explain what are the passages that the salty water will pass through?
Yes, we have first the Great Belt here. There are actually three passages in reality. We have the Great Belt, the Öresund, which is slightly below this level now, and the Little Belt, which is all completely below this level. And then it will, the deep furrow goes down here between Lolland and Langeland and between Lolland and this Fehmarn here, the German island. And this is the Fehmarn Belt out to the Arkona Basin. And that is, this is a very long, narrow furrow, which is approximately 20, 25 meters deep in at the threshold. So it's actually a difficult passage for the water to enter. And that is the main reason why we don't get so much salt water into the Baltic, because of this long, narrow stretch.
So now we can see that the salty, darker water is coming into one of the first basins down there. What would you call that one?
Well, this is still down in the Belt Sea. Mm-hmm. And
what about the northern passage? Is that not catching up yet?
Let me do like this. Mm-hmm. It's above the level now. It's above the level. So there's no water entering at Öresund. Well, let me just point out to make everyone happy here that this is, of course, a very crude model in if we compare it to reality. It's not possible to make a true model in this, to make a true happening in a model of this scale, 1 to 1 million. And this is only for pedagogical reasons, not for, it couldn't be used for any scientific conclusions, really. But the principle works the same as in the reality. Mm. Now we can see that the water is starting to pass by between Lolland and Fehmarn.
And the first basin that's going to be reached by the salty water, what do you call that one? It's
The water which I just opened up for here in Öresund is now making its way rapidly down to Arkona Basin, which is named after Cap Arkona here in Germany. And it's now filling up that basin. That basin has got a depth of about 50 meters. And when that is filled up, it will reach the threshold here in the Bornholm Gut, and the threshold is at 45 meters depth. So it's a shallow basin.
So we will stay with you for another minute or so and see if the Arkona Basin is filled up, and then the water will continue, I suppose, by coming over the threshold there.
Yes, we will let the model run and see what happens, and let's return to it later in the program.
We can return to it several times later, because there are a lot of things that will happen. We will see the salty water, I guess, all the way up to the northern part of Gotland. Well, then we leave the model for the time being, and we are continuing with the drainage area. That is the 4/5 of the Baltic region that is not the water. And Lars, how would you go about to describe such a vast area and diverse area as the Baltic region?
Well, we will try to describe it in several ways. And the content of this entire session has deliberately not been focused on traditional geosciences like geology and physical geography, but towards geoecology. That means the study of interactions between abiotic and biotic factors on the Baltic ecosystems and on environmental issues.
I see. And what do you mean by abiotic and biotic factors?
Well, biotic is biological factors, and abiotic is non-biological factors.
Good. That's a couple of new words that we all need to learn as part of this program, I guess. And if we have this approach, the geoecological approach, perhaps we should start by learning something about the history of the region. And again, I think Ulf has prepared something for us.
Since the geology of the drainage area has profound implications for the environmental situation, I think we should have a look at how the geology of this drainage area influences and how it has evolved during the last 20,000 years. Looking at this bedrock map, we first see some areas with mountains. They consist of material that has been pushed together by continental drift. Next, we see the so-called hard rock, granite, gneiss, etc. They are 1 to 2 billion years old. After this follows the sedimentary rocks, added here in order of decreasing age. Generally speaking, the younger they are, the looser are they. Note that hard rocks are found in the northwest and looser rocks in the southeast. Usually, the bedrock is covered by a more or less thick layer of loose deposits of Quaternary age, that is, less than 2 million years old. Let's have a look at how they were formed. The last 15 million years, the temperature in Europe has been falling. 2 million years ago, this led to an instability in the climate that induced violent fluctuations in the temperature. This has caused at least 3 major ice ages in the Scandinavian area. The ice sheet in Scandinavia was more than 2 kilometers thick, but the ice that advanced over the Baltic Sea to the continent was only a few hundred meters thick, since it was floating on the water. This animation is based on a computer simulation of the advancing ice. The latest ice age had a maximum 20,000 years ago, but was completely melted 8,000 years ago. When the inland ice grew, it took water from the world oceans. The water in the sea sunk by up to 100 meters as the ice grew to thicknesses of 2 or 3 kilometers. The immense weight of the ice pressed down the Earth's crust. When the ice melted, the sea level rose instantaneously as the meltwater entered the sea. But the crust that has been depressed in Scandinavia only slowly rose again, and it is still rising. Hence, the world oceans temporarily could cover large areas under the former ice. On this suit of maps, we see the result in the Baltic region. Note the succession of ice, lake, land. This is the present situation, and if we continue into the future, this is what it will look like in 1,000 years from now. The ice eroded the bedrock. The direction of ice movement can be seen from the striations on this Roche Moutonnée. The eroded material was picked up by the ice, transported and deposited closer to the ice margin. The deposit is called till, which is an unsorted mixture of any grain sizes. Since much material was transported from Scandinavia to the continent, and since the bedrock in Scandinavia is mostly hard rock, the landscape here is dominated by thin, infertile till deposits, suitable only for forestry or grazing. If the material carried by the ice is not deposited directly from the melting ice, but is transported by the glacial meltwater, then it will be sorted according to size. Ice river deposits are found in long narrow ridges, or eskers, like this. It may also be found in ice lake deltas or in sandos. A sander is a fan-shaped deposit formed in front of an ice margin on land, and sanders are found along the southern margin of the last ice sheet. It is the green fields on this map. The third deposit, which is of major importance, is the ice lake deposits that sedimented in glacial lakes. The fine material that was sorted out from the ice river deposits slowly accumulated on the bottoms of the first lake that the water entered. Many of those bottoms have now become dry land due to the land uplift. These clay-covered valley bottoms are today the principal farmlands of Sweden and Finland, whether in small fields or in large plains. Formerly, during previous glaciations,
The ice margin was even farther south and east. The most recently glaciated areas are geomorphologically young. The rivers are often interrupted by lakes and by rapids. And the entire landscape has a hillocky appearance, except on the clay plains that you saw earlier. The mature landscape, on the other hand, away from the last glaciation, is more smooth. It is dominated by river processes. The rivers are without lakes or rapids, but they frequently have moving sandbars. But what about the future? We know for sure that there will be another ice age. But stay cool. It won't be here for many thousand years to come.
Is it possible to, right from the geological history, conclude something about the environmental properties of the area? What do you say, Lars?
Well, the bedrocks and the quaternary deposits vary very much and give rise to soils with very different sensitivities to acidifying substances and toxic substances. For example, where the bedrocks are acidic, there is a low buffering capacity to acidifying substances like sulfur. And for example, in areas with a high soil permeability and an intense agriculture, we quite often find, for example, poisoned wells where the water is poisoned by nitrogen compounds.
Nitrate. So what would these areas be? Can you give us one example of an area with the nitrate poisoning in the wells?
Well, there are several examples. For example, in Denmark and Lithuania.
And what about the sensitivity to acid rain?
Well,
where should we prefer to stay if we want to avoid the consequences?
The most severe consequences of acid rain would be in poor till areas, moraine areas.
Like
in northern Sweden.
And what about Poland? Not so much.
Not so much, no.
Well, another consequence of geology is, of course, the way we can use the land. Just as you said, there are some areas, there are agriculture, and other areas it's not possible. So let's discuss that point. Now, I think, Ulf, you prepared something for us.
Yes, let's have a look at the land use. The land use is to a large extent explained by the geology. Looking at the forest on this, the dark green areas on this map, for instance, we see that the areas in Sweden and Finland, where we have a lot of forests, are areas with hard rocks, the red areas on this map, and simultaneously till on this map. So together, they explain to a large extent why we have forests. And where there are other combinations, we have other land uses.
Well, do you have a comment on this?
Well, one comment might be that there are very many areas for research. And one such very interesting area is to study the linkages between land use and water quality and to try to quantify such linkages.
And that is being done somewhere? At one of the universities in the Baltic University Network?
For example, in Uppsala.
In Uppsala, very good. Well, land use is, of course, quite essential for what is brought to the Baltic Sea through all the rivers. And I think one of the most important of these rivers is the Wisła, the large Polish river. And Dr. Andrzej Kowalczewski here has prepared a short video for us about Wisła.
For the hydrology of Poland, the most important is the Vistula River. This river, which is just above 1,000 kilometers long, drains about 60% of the area of whole Poland. This area, which is roughly like that. Is used for various purposes, and the utilization of the land of whole Poland reflects, in fact, in the conditions or state of the Vistula River. The colors used on this map indicate clear waters, really clear waters, which are suitable for all purposes. The worst is the red color, which is, in our standards, above all classes. It is water which is no good for no reasons. Those are in between. We can see that the Vistula, starting in the region of Tatra Mountains, gets, of course, the zero class water, the very best water, and on the way it is full of colors. The width of this band indicates the flow, with such a distance equal to 1,000 meters per second. We see clearly that just after the river really is created, its waters are very poor indeed. This is because of the influence of the industrial area located in this place. The waters are very saline and are very polluted. This industrial area, in fact, is quite significant for the rest of the river. The river should purify by itself if it would not be receiving other polluted effluents. However, other rivers inflowing into the Vistula River are often polluted. Luckily, not all of them. We see that in few places there is a trace of blue, of good waters. This inflow of better waters is improving the Vistula, and we may see that in certain places still above Warsaw, which is the Polish capital located here, it is not in a very bad shape. However, this central part of Poland is Poland mainly with the agriculture. Those agricultural lands also influence the state of the river, loading their nutrients, nutrients which allow for the rich development of life in the river. By reaching in the close to the Baltic area, the river improves itself a bit. This is because the drainage of poorly developed areas in, with not very good agriculture, and of course the river slows down very much, and the processes of sedimentation allow the river to purify itself. The amount of nutrients and pollutants transported along by the Vistula during a year result in the pollution and eutrophication of the Gdańsk Bay and influence the whole Baltic Sea.
There are a number of rivers that drain the Baltic region, and Ulf Hesse has always prepared a map that will show them.
Yes, let's have the map on the screen. Yeah, I've added the maps here in order of decreasing size, where the size is measured as discharge in cubic meters per second at the mouth. The largest one is, of course, Neva, then we have Wisła, Daugava, etc. You can see that the largest rivers are found in the southeast, whereas Sweden, the Swedish mountains, are drained by many smaller rivers instead.
Yeah, the most important river here, Neva, is where you live, Victor. Do you have a comment on what it looks like?
The Neva is a really special river because, first of all, it is short and power stream which transport fresh water from the large lake system from east to the west into the Gulf of Finland. And second, because the Neva discharge the industrial pollutions not only from the Petersburg It is the largest industrial center in the Baltic Europe, but from the Ladoga Lake. And from the Ladoga Lake, Neva transport not only industrial, but on and agriculture pollutions too.
Well, so it's just as serious as the Wisła.
Yeah.
So, well, if we go back to the model, we will very clearly see that, in fact, Neva is practically part of the large lake system up to the right. That's, you see also Ladoga is filled with water in this model. And we can also see that a lot of things has happened. Perhaps, Ulf, you can describe where the...
Yes. Well, last time we saw it, we were at the Arkona Basin, if we can see the model again. And now the water has continued between Bornholm and Sweden to fill the Bornholm Basin, and then through the narrow Stolpe furrow and up to the area east of Gotland, which is called the Gotland Deep. And it's continuing north and seeking its way to the deepest part in the Baltic Sea. But let's return to that later.
Now, perhaps we should deal a little with the coast, that is, just between the rivers, the drainage area, and the Baltic itself. Well, I think we have a map of the coast. Perhaps you want to comment on that, Lars?
Well, this picture gives a genetic coastal classification, which presents a large-scale qualitative picture of the distribution of five different coast types: archipelagos, fjords, open low-water coasts, clint coasts, and lagoons.
Of course, these coasts now are quite critical from many points of view, and would you be able to summarize some of the main properties of the coasts?
Well, the coasts are generally regarded as a nursery and a pantry, meaning that they produce very much, and the production is important, not only for life in the coast, but also for life in the open sea. And the coast is also a zone of conflicts. Very many parties have demands on the coast. And it's also regarded as a purification plant of emissions from land to the sea.
Of course, we'll come back to that later aspect, but when you talk about conflict of interest, can you mention a few interests?
Well, for example, shipping, fishing, aquaculture, sailing, recreation, and industries.
And all that take place at the coast.
Yes.
Okay, we will show you some of these coasts around the Baltic that's so diverse by a movie that we put together from contributions from several of the universities in the Baltic University Network. And we hope it will show you perhaps not so much of the scientific aspects right now, but perhaps more of the beauty. So enjoy the Baltic coasts.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is William Haber. I am head of landscape architecture department belonging to the University of Agriculture in Poznań, Poland. Nice to meet you at the screen. The aim of my video film, which I am going to present you, is to give you some information about the Polish coastal zone problems, with a special consideration to the green areas adhering to this zone. The Baltic coastal line adhering to Poland is even, smooth, without gulfs and fjords. Only the width of beaches and the height of shores are differentiated. Looking along the beaches, we can see that in some places there are post-glacial hills. A high, steep cliff shore occurs rather rarely. The greatest number of beaches are separated from the land by moderately elevated dunes, and behind them there grows a belt of forests which forms a natural surrounding of the coast. Its width ranges from several tens of meters to several kilometers, and sometimes It enters into the land for several tens of kilometers. The forests are present on about 70% of the Polish coastal line. In the flat coastal zone adhering to the sea, there are 11 lakes. For instance, this one, it is Livia Uža, the smallest of all, becoming grown over because of contamination. Jamno is strongly contaminated, shallowing non-stop since 1920. From that time, the level of bottom raised up about 2 meters. Bukovo is a middle-sized lake with clear water because this lake is situated far away from hamlets, that means villages, and from recreation centers. All the lakes are shallow delta-shaped lakes connected with the sea. Right now we see at the screen the mouth of Dzhivna River. This river is connecting the Baltic Sea with the Pomerian Bay. Dzhivna, that means strange river. Why strange? Because this river is flowing alternately once to the sea and then from the sea to the bay. This is a real strange, but true. Everybody can observe this, but when, it is always a surprise. Sometimes it flows in the surface to the sea, and the water near bottom flows in opposite direction. Our sand is generally clean, loose and dry, and it causes that the Polish beaches are subjected to wind and water erosion. This causes the destruction of the coastal line frequently shifted. In this way, the Church of Reval was destroyed by the sea. The church was built in 14th century, 2 kilometers away from the sea shore, and today there are only ruins. And this is result of erosion of the cliff shore on which the church was built. Another example is the forest grown on a high shore nearby Międzyzdroje, being constantly attacked by waves and winds. How much is the destroying power of the waves shows the picture of broken breakwater of the mole in Kołobrzeg. Such a sandy cliff like on the screen is quite easy to destroy by the waves. One of the methods of reducing the power of waves is to place such concrete trestles at the beach, or to build such concrete walls, or to cover the shore with such blocks, big stones or pieces of concrete. But all the methods from the point of view of nature lover are not to be accepted. First of all, the existing vegetation must be protected and the surrounding of beaches must be strengthened by new plantations. The sand of the Baltic dunes is strongly salted. Its reaction is slightly basic and it almost has no nutrients available to plants. In the sand, only such species can grow that show a high tolerance to the environment in which they live. At the same time, these species must develop long branching roots to bind the loose sand of the coast. Among the known plants, lyne grass, that means Elemus arenarius, is best suited for consolidating the dunes and the surroundings of the beaches at the southern line of the Baltic Sea.
South of the Baltic Sea coast, between Gdańsk and Kaliningrad, There are wonderful sandy spits. They stretch between the sea and the gulfs. In some places, dunes of the spits resemble Sahara desert landscapes. The dunes are mostly covered by forest. Sometimes sand transport occurs in places exposed to strong wind. The Kaliningrad area is famous for the Kherson Spit, which is situated between the towns of Zelenogradsk and Klaipeda in Lithuania. The spit is about 100 kilometers long. Some parts of the forests are inhabited by wild boars, elks, and deers. This is a good place for hunting. Over 200 species of birds fly over the spit every year. They fly mostly at night. The landscape is picturesque but vulnerable. Man pollutes the waters of the gulfs, destroys the forests, and kills rare animals. The Kherson Spit is now a national park for dune landscape protection. The dune complex is about 5,000 years old. Its formation began with the retreat of the last glacier of Fennoscandia. The waves of the sea discharged much sand of glacial origin to the sea coast. Shelves and isolated islands were finally transformed to spits. Gradually, the dunes were covered by vegetation. Animals and human beings came. Today, there are settlements of fishermen, forest guards, and hunters. In summer, thousands of tourists visit the area. It is important to preserve this unique dune complex in the coastal landscapes of the southeast of the Baltic for the future.
On many places in the Baltic, the coast is made of limestone, which has been eroded into steep cliffs called clints. Off the shore, the sea is deep. The clints are found in Denmark, south of Copenhagen, in western Estonia, and on the big islands, Gotland and Bornholm, where they are very impressive and allow a magnificent view. The coast is full of small bays and coves, forming a dramatic landscape. On Gotland, large caves have been eroded into the calcareous rock. The limestone was once formed by fossil corals, traces of life several hundred million years old.
The archipelago outside the Swedish capital of Stockholm consists of a multitude of larger and smaller islands. These pictures are from the outer archipelago, not more than 50 kilometers from the capital. The Baltic archipelagos were formed along the Finnish and Swedish coasts when the inland ice eroded all but the hardest parts of the bedrock. The land uprise created the islands that we see today. For instance, the Longvik Square area had only two islands during Bronze Age. Several had appeared at Viking Age, and there are many more today. The beautiful archipelago landscape, or seascape, is unique in the world. There are 25,000 islands in the Stockholm archipelago alone. The Åland archipelago is even larger. In the beginning of the century, the inhabitants of the many small islets led a life of great variation. Agriculture and fishing were their main activities. Seal hunting, as well as hunting of waterfowl and collection of their eggs, also made an important contribution to their living. They built their own boats, but still were isolated during spring and autumn, when the ice did not carry nor allow boats to pass. Summer life was pleasant, but winter often hard and lonely. Today the population has decreased considerably. it is no longer possible for the relatives of the fishermen from last century to earn their living in the traditional way. Development of new trades, however, has made it possible for some of them to stay and even for newcomers to settle. One such trade is fish farming, that is now an important source of income for many families. Today, many people enjoy the beauty and nature of the archipelagos, since they have become important recreational areas in the Baltic.
Welcome back from your coast trip. Here in Uppsala, we think it's time to play some music. There are quite a number of student orchestras in Uppsala, and one of them is here. This is Kruthornen. Kruthornen actually means about gunpowder horns. It's difficult to translate, it's a Swedish pun. But anyhow, we expect some very explosive music.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fru Tonen. Thank you. And also thank you to Christer Hjort, who is the band leader. I guess you played it in honor of our guest from Russia. And we will continue eastwards in the direction of Russia to do some more serious business, but in Finland. And there is a coastal type that we did not include in the first trip there, but now we'll do so. It's a fjord-like type of coast that they have in Finland, and one of these places is Pohjoviken, where Helsinki University is doing some research.
Tectonic inlets, which penetrate through the archipelago of thousands of rocky islands. The water exchange between the open sea and coastal areas is restricted, resulting in a complicated pattern of brackish water communities. Geographical gradients in wave exposure, sedimentation, and hydrographical conditions, especially in salinity, makes the area an extraordinary microcosm, which enables ecological investigations in the area where the open Baltic Sea and continental freshwaters meet and mixture. By the open sea, the rocky skerries are surrounded by algal vegetation. But more near the continent, the islands are covered by forests and extensive growths of the common reed. This tells us the influence of fresh water and depositing fine sediments on the shore. Pohjoviken is 20 kilometers long narrow bay east from Hangö Peninsula. It is fairly deep, more than 40 meters in maximum, but isolated by a shallow sill near the town of Ekenäs. Consequently, Pohjoviken is a good example of area with a brackish water penetration and freshwater outflow, influenced also by cultural eutrophication. Here, in the northern corner of the bay, waters from the river Mustiojoki create a surface layer with low salinity. Rich littoral vegetation indicates the occurrence of soft bottom sediments and influence of eutrophic fresh water. In the winter, the river outflow forms more than 2 meters thick layer under the ice, and fresh water extends far to the outer archipelago from the bay itself. For many marine plants and animals, this is critical time of the year because they must endure an osmotic shock in fresh water under the ice. Scientists from Tvärminen Geological Station have studied ecology and hydrographical conditions in Pohjoviken from the beginning of this century. Investigations indicate that a strong density gradient separates surface water from cold saline deep water, which in the autumn penetrates into the bay, improving the oxygen conditions in the deepest areas. In this diagram, we see conditions in the autumn. However, in the summer, strong thermocline and halocline effectively prevent the inflow, and deep waters will be stagnated in Pohjoviken. In these conditions, oxygen will be soon consumed by biological respiration activities, a situation which is familiar to us from the deepest parts of the Baltic proper itself. Oxygen contents in Puyuviken have, however, predictable seasonal pattern. The variation between late summer and winter being greatest in deep water. Modern research equipment, such as computer operated sound, improve the possibilities for continuous monitoring of the bay. This is necessary because the frequency and length of anaerobic periods in Puyuviken have increased in recent years. These water samples demonstrate the situation. The brown color of the bottles become weaker, almost white, in deep areas of the bay, which indicates very low oxygen values. Samples collected from the benthic communities are without animal life, and the black color of the sediment indicates anaerobic conditions. In future, we are forced to ask.
That was a rather pessimistic end of that movie, but let's go back to ourselves and ask if some of our students have a question.
Well, yes, I have a question.
Yes, please.
About the oxygen level in the Baltic. If you were speculating, what would the level be in some decades with and without human activity in this area, activities like agriculture and industry?
Well, thank you. Of course, that's quite a difficult question. What will happen in 20 years from now? Andrei, would you say something about the oxygen concentration in the bottom?
I would say that we will expect, in fact, the depletion of the oxygen level in the deeper waters. Surely, the oxygen comes to these waters from two ways. One, it is the effect of photosynthesis in the top layers of the sea. And the second source of oxygen is the very irregular inflows of salty and well-oxygenated waters of the Atlantic Ocean. So, all organic matter produced in the upper layers is decomposing in the sea, and it is obviously decomposing for a long time by the sediment in the deep waters. So, if this oxygen is utilized and we have another injection of Atlantic waters, well, we don't see the result. But if the situation is that this happens in the area where there is no injection, we observe a real tendency to have no oxygen, really. That's it.
Of course, we should add that we are in quite an extreme situation now, with a very long time since there was a large influx of Atlantic water. It was in the early 70s. And also that there is a high demand on oxygen because of all the fertilizers and nitrogen load. We'll come back to that in two sessions, so we will talk about it a lot later on. Let's see if there are some more questions. I hope we have contact with some other universities. Yes. Is there a telephone contact? Hello.
Hello, hello, Aris.
Ah, hello, how are you doing?
This is very, very fantastic feeling here in Portania building.
Yeah.
We have about 350 students here.
Very nice. This is Helsinki, and I believe it's Heikko Salamai.
Yes, Heikki's here. Yeah.
Very nice. Do you have one of these 350 students who want to ask a question?
Okay, we have here.
Hello?
Yes.
I'm
Hello?
From the Helsinki University.
Well, welcome to the Baltic University. What would you like to ask?
Well, I have a question concerning the future of the Baltic. Because
yes.
We know a lot about the late history of the Baltic, but can we tell anything about the future? I'd like to ask you about the reliability of today's ecosystem models and simulations and the time scale of such models. How far can they go? Can they tell really us something about how the sea will be changed, for example, under the greenhouse effect, if and when the ice cover will be missing? Do you think it's possible to draw any detailed conclusions regarding the most recent trends?
Well, thank you. That was quite an enormous question, I must say. But let's say, I think the land uprise is pretty well controlled by today's models. Ulf, do you have?
Yes, in the northern areas of the Baltic, in the Botnian Bay, there is a maximum land uplift of 9 meters per 1,000 years. Mm-hmm. But of course, in the Sound and the Belts, there is no land uplift. So the mm-hmm. Baltic Sea is getting smaller every year. But that's a slow process.
I see. Okay. And the other one, and the, what is the time frame here? In 1,000 years
yes,
time?
Yes, this was 9 meters on 1,000 years. Mm-hmm.
So the other question, what will happen in case of global warming? Now, Andrei, would you like to comment on that again?
Well, one of the real effects of this greenhouse effect is that the temperature would rise, you see. And the rise of temperature will result, obviously, in the quickening of all biological processes in water. We will have quicker production rate, we will have quicker decomposition rate. So this will result, in fact, in the stronger eutrophication of the Baltic Sea.
Mm. What about oceanologists' point of view, Victor? Yeah. Do you have?
If we really have the greenhouse effect, we will see the sea level, rise of sea level in the ocean. And on the other hand, we will see the rise of sea level in the Baltic, because we will see the main, more rain precipitation.
Yes.
And we really need to keep in mind two processes of this.
Okay, thank you. Is the student from Helsinki still there?
Yes, no? I am.
Well, are you happy with the answers? Or?
Yes, I think I'm quite happy with it.
Yeah, thank you. We will continue to discuss. Now, do we have a third telephone call? Or? Hello? I guess we tried to get in contact with Copenhagen, actually. Is there a hello? Yes. Yeah, I can hear you very weakly. I guess it's Axel.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, it's Axel Valle Hansen, who is actually our contact person in Copenhagen. Do you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes. How do you have any students down there?
Yes, we have one, Kjell Hansen, a student of physics. Geophysics, he would like to ask a question to you.
Please go ahead.
Hello. Are you there?
Yes, please, we are waiting for the question.
Okay, I have a question. If we stop artificial supply of nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus right now, how long will it take the Baltic Sea to recover to normal conditions?
Well, thank you. I think we heard the question, how long time will it take for the Baltic Sea to return to normal conditions in case eutrophication stops? Well, you have an answer to that, Lars?
Well, the wise man has said that it's always difficult to predict, especially about the future.
Yes, I guess so.
So I would guess that we would find very many types of models and very many types of predictions. Mm-hmm. And the crucial factor here would be the water retention time and the actual decrease.
Yes, and that's, of course, quite difficult to say something about. But
yes.
We will talk more about this in the third session that deal with eutrophication. Now, I think it's time to continue. Thank you in Copenhagen and good luck down there. And we will continue with some specialized information here. And what is that, Lars, again?
This session we deal with modern techniques. There are parts on geographical information systems, GIS, and on expert systems. And these are systems where one uses the computer to get overview and synthesis in very complicated issues and on extended data.
So we'll see that little movie on the computer systems.
Hello. Now I'm going to show you the geographical information system that I've used for making the maps in this session. In a GIS, I can feed any kind of geographical data using, for instance, this digitizing table. The GIS can be used for displaying the information as maps on the screen, but also for doing calculations with the geographical information. Let me show you an example. In the 1960s, a new island was born south of Iceland, called Surtsey. It provided a splendid opportunity for quantifying coastal processes, a kind of nature's own laboratory. In order to quantify the change, I fed two maps into the GIS. This one from 1967, and this one which we made in 1989. You can see already on the maps that there is a great deal of difference, but we can quantify it by means of a simple subtraction. Elevation 1989 minus elevation 1967. As a result, we get this difference map, where the red tones denote erosion and the green tones accumulation of material. I've also added 10-meter contour lines to the original coastline for your orientation. As you might have guessed by now, the GIS is an excellent system for all environmental planning, and you will soon see how it can be used in coastal planning in the Baltic Sea.
So far, we have seen how various geographical information systems have been used to produce maps of the Baltic. Now we will give one further example of this modern technique. To my right here, you see a very old building belonging to Uppsala University. Inside we have the Department of Hydrology. Johan Persson will present a new system for coastal water management.
Hello. At this place, we're working with a system for coastal water management. The idea is to extract as much information as possible from a depth map, information that can be used for coastal water management. Here, we have a digitizing tablet where we can transfer depth information, shoreline information, etc. to the personal computer. The digitized data is used to construct 2- and 3-dimensional maps. We can also calculate parameters describing the size and the shape of the coastal area. We call them morphometric parameters. In this printout, we have the total shoreline length. The morphometric information is also used in various types of empirical models. With the models, we can determine properties of the coast. The most important properties are the water exchange, sediment characteristics, and biological production.
We have seen how data on coastal size and form parameters may be obtained from this computerized system. Our next part deals with that problem. Mats Wallin is a staff member of the Department of Hydrology. He has been working with coastal management issues for several years.
First, we will look on the coastal zone of the Baltic Sea. As we can see on the map, the coastal zone is a very narrow zone between land and the open sea. One can say that the coastal zone functions as a filter or purification plant for different pollutants and sediment transported from land to the open sea. And different types of coastal areas, of course, have different filtering capacity. It is possible to quantify the filtering capacity by using three key factors. The first is the morphometry, that is, size and shape of the area. This allows us to calculate volumes and thereby concentrations of pollutants. The second is the water exchange. During the warmer part of the year, the water mass is clearly divided in warmer surface water and cooler deep water. If we have a quick surface water exchange, the concentration of pollutants will be low, and if the deep water exchange is slow, there is a risk for oxygen depletion in the deeper parts. The third factor is the bottom dynamics. Areas with soft, muddy bottoms will accumulate sediments and pollutants, while in areas with hard bottoms, these will be transported away. The three key factors are used in load models. These are empirical models that we have developed for relatively small bays in the Baltic, where wave and wind activity dominate the water exchange. The load models essentially calculates the retention of pollutants in the coast. If the pollutant is retained, the environmental effect is high, and so is the filtering capacity. We say that this is a high sensitivity coast. A given load of a pollutant, such as nutrients, will have very different effects depending on the sensitivity of the coastal area.
This session is about expert systems. These computerized systems are meant to provide structure and overview in extremely complicated matters like environmental consequence analysis. This system is for aquatic environments, for oceans, coasts, lakes, and rivers. And we see rather corny icons here, but these are bottoms. And if you press a button, we can get information, for example, on literature references. And we will press this button for coastal areas. And then we see, let's say, a tree with two branches. One branch for geographical information systems, GIS, and one for the expert system. We will go into the expert system. We can see that we have four major threats. Nutrients causing eutrophication. We can press an explain button. Toxic substances, acidifying substances, and complex wastewaters. And now we will press the button for nutrients eutrophications of coastal areas. Here we can see that there are four bottoms for environmental effects of nutrients: seca depth, chlorophyll, sedimentation, and oxygen concentration. And behind these bottles, there are models. We will press seca depth. And in this chart, we see four different models for the seca depth transparency. All these models require different types of input data. For example, on total nitrogen, on the section area, and on areas of accumulation. Let's press model 3. And these are the traffic rules that goes with that particular model. This model can only be applied on the specific conditions. We will test this model for one coastal area in Finland. It's called Djupfjärden, and that means the deep bay. And we also have specific data for this particular bay. And the idea is to test the conditions in this bay. So these are data from Djupfjärden. We have sensitivity parameters, water surface area, mean depth, proportion accumulation bottoms, 30%. The surface water retention time is 5 days. And the total atmospheric load of nitrogen is 650 kilograms. Now, if we put these data into the model, run the model, here is the model. The dose was 650 kilograms per year. The areas of accumulation were 30% of the bottom area, and the water retention time of the surface water was 5 days. And this is the seck depth calculated by means of this model. It should be 3.4 to 3.7. That's the clarity of the water. So this is the effect dose sensitivity diagram, where we have oligotrophic conditions, mesotrophic, eutrophic, and very eutrophic conditions. Very eutrophic conditions have very low transparency of the water. And we have doses on the x-axis and sensitivity on these particular curves. So we have, for one and the same dose, different sensitivities, and we will obtain different seck depths. In our case, we had 3.7 meters. And empirically, for this particular bay, we have determined that the seck depth is 3.8 meters, and that's rather good. Now, assuming that we will have a fish farm in this particular bay with 150 tons of fish production, that would increase the load of nitrogen with 740 kilograms to 1,500 kilograms per square kilometer per year. If we change the parameters to 1,500 kilograms with the same areas of accumulation, 30%, with the same water retention time, 5 days, we will have a new seck depth, and the seck depth will be lower, much lower. Here we will have not 3.7, but rather 2.6 meters. And we can also see if we have no or only a very low dose of nitrogen. Here we had 75, that's inside the range. The same sensitivity, 30%, same water retention time. And now we can see that the seck depth is 4 meters. So if there were no dose of nitrogen except for the natural dose, the seck depth, the natural seck depth,
so there was a lot of talking about secchi here. What is actually secchi, Lars?
Well, secchi is the name of an Italian scientist, Angelo Secchi, who in 1866 invented a device, a very simple white painted disc to measure water clarity or water transparency.
Mm-hmm. So you sink that down in the water and see when it disappears, I guess.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So that's the seck depth, that decreases when the load increases.
That's right.
Okay, so we are on the way to the bottom, as everybody can hear, and we would like to do that more seriously by showing a movie on bottom and bottom research that was prepared.
Most of us are familiar with the fabulous underwater world of Jacques Cousteau, but how many of you know what it looks like on the bottoms of the Baltic Sea? It doesn't intrigue us in the same way. It's green instead of blue, it's dark, and above all, it's cold. But the water can be clear. This picture was taken at 32 meters depth on the shoal in the Bornholm Gut. This is the so-called winter water, and the temperature is close to freezing. That's the reason why it is so clear. Looking at the bottom, the boulders have been washed out from the till left by the ice age. That happened when the water level was at the lowest here. That is, when the Baltic Sea was connected to the world oceans over central Sweden. The washed out material has been concentrated in marine sand and mud deposits. Here we see rippled coarse sand at 29 meters depth off Christiansø, north of Bornholm. The ripples indicate that the waves can, from time to time, put the sand in motion even at this depth. But during long periods with tranquil weather, this nearby bottom will act as a temporary accumulation bottom for organic material. Dead algae will fill the depression in this photo, and the mud will kill any higher life under it.
That's why we can see the depression as a lighter area devoid of muscles. Storms bring the mud back into suspension, as can be detected with this instrument, the sedimeter. Some nutrients are recycled to the water by the resuspension, whereas other parts of the sediment are transported down current to the final accumulation areas. In this case, the mud starts at 40 meters depth on the lee side of Kristiansø. Thus, one can make a distinction of transport and accumulation bottoms for material of a certain grain size. You might wonder how one goes about to gather all the data needed to construct a map over transport and accumulation bottoms. Obviously, one cannot dive on all the locations. A modern and cost-efficient way is to use a side-scan sonar, which is an acoustical subaquatical remote sensing device. It can be thought of as an underwater radar. The side-scan sonar delivers a map of the bottom as the survey vessel travels through the water. The mapping can be made at a speed of several square kilometers per hour. The gray level of the sonograph reflects the bottom type. Coarse sediments are dark, finer sediments are lighter. If there is gas in the sediment surface, the sonograph will be very dark. In this case, the sonar has registered 200 meters on each side of the survey vessel, as shown here. The side-scan sonar also registers the topography, for instance, the iceberg furrows from the ice age and these tracks produced by trawling. The sonographs can be mounted together side by side, producing a map over a large area. In this case, the east coast of Skåne, showing a part of the Bornholm Gut. But this map needs to be interpreted. It's very helpful to use a sub-bottom profiler simultaneously with the side-scan sonar. The sub-bottom profiler looks down into the sediments, and the resulting profile can be used to measure how thick different sediment layers are and to help deduce what they consist of. But to get a positive interpretation, one needs to take up some of the sediments and analyze it. With this corer, a several decimeters long core can be taken up from soft bottoms. Subsamples can be taken out and analyzed, but that is time consuming. A faster method involves X-raying the cores as a first step. On the X-ray photo, we see all the fine sediment structures that were invisible for the bare eye. In order to quantify the water content in the core, a computer calculates the vertical distribution of it. From this curve, one can easily identify if it is a bottom of continuous accumulation or whether there is intermittent resuspension. However, the state-of-the-art methods that you have just seen have generally not been used in the Baltic Sea. This suggests that much remains to be learned when modern methods are applied to the investigation of the Baltic Sea bottoms.
Well, you seem to be quite familiar with those bottoms, Ulf. Did you dive a lot yourself? Or?
Yes, I did when doing my research in that area.
Mm-hmm. One of the most surprising things, which I didn't expect at all, was these trawl spores, trawling spores. Tracks from the trawls. What are those of importance, or what do you think? Do you have a comment on that? Or?
Well, the tracks itself may not be all that important, but trawling is really a significant process. For example, in the Kattegat area in the mid-80s, trawling resuspended every square meter at least once every month, and increased resuspension means increased internal loading of nutrients and increased eutrophication. So resuspension is a very important process, and trawling is very important to trigger resuspension.
So you think we should ban bottom trawling?
No.
No. If we continue with the Baltic Sea itself, it's time to talk about the water exchange in a little more systematic manner. And actually, we have a short prepared contribution from Warszawa.
The Baltic Sea belongs to the semi-closed groups of seas. The water balance of such a sea has the receiving side, the inflow of river L, atmospheric precipitation P, and inflow from the Atlantic Ocean M. On the other side, it has an evaporation E and outflow to the ocean H. Storage difference, that means retention, delta V. It's marked that delta V. The mean yearly values for the Baltic Sea area as follow: supply of fresh water, that means P, E, and L, and net exchange with the sea, H minus M. In the situation of Baltic Sea, that means that mean yearly values of precipitation 230 kilometers square, evaporation 180 kilometers square, river inflow 430 kilometers square. Thus, the outflow to the Atlantic Ocean through Danish Straits, equals 480 kilometers square per year. The relation of the above values change significantly during a year. They also vary in the distinguished seven regions of the sea. It's seven regions of the Baltic Sea: Botnian Bay, Botnian Sea, Kattegat, Danish Strait, and Gulf of Riga, Gulf of Finland, and of course Baltic proper. The values of evaporation from the sea surface is quite variable from year to year. In dry years, an evaporation may reach up to 220 kilometers square per year. Such years are very variable for the ecological condition of the sea, as then there is quite a possibility of an inflow of clean and saline, well oxygenated water from the Atlantic Ocean. The same, from the environmental point of view, such negative water balance of the Baltic, when evaporation losses exceed the precipitation and river addition, is beneficial for the renewal of waters due to injection from Atlantic waters.
So let's go and see how our own little experiment in water exchange has proceeded since time we have looked at it last. We hope that we can get that into the picture, the inflow of the blue salty water in the model. We are waiting for that picture. There we are. Now there is a lot of more who has come in. Ulf, what's your comment on that?
Yes, now the water has continued past Gotland, past first the Gotland Deep, the Fårö Deep, and then rounded Gotland and down in the Landsort Deep, which is the deepest of all parts in the Baltic. And it's also continued south to the Karlsö Deep. And we can see some salt water inflow to the Gdansk Basin.
And that is about what one could expect if it's a maximum water inflow, which we would be very happy if it could occur. Now, let's see what's happening on the surface of the Baltic. I think we have a small video on the streams on the surface. And Lars, what's your comment to that?
Well, the dominating water circulation in each basin, like the Botnian Bay and the Baltic proper, constitutes an anti-clockwise cell, which redistributes and distributes the settling particles and the pollutants in a very typical pattern, reflecting the flow of the water. This anti-clockwise cell is linked to the rotation of the Earth, which deflects any plume of flowing water to the right in relation to the direction of the flow on the northern hemisphere.
Yes, so it's very different on the surface as compared to the deep part.
Yes, and the model that we see here is really not very realistic for the surface water.
No, it's very different. Yes, I understand that. Now, if we look at one of the really major discussions that has been going on here, it's about the impact of large technical projects on the circulation of the water. And there are two such projects that we have discussed. The first one deals with the dam that has been constructed in Leningrad or St. Petersburg. But when the dam was constructed, it was, of course, Leningrad. But I know that Victor here has prepared a short video, so let's have a look at what it looks like at the Leningrad dam.
We are here in the heart of Leningrad just to demonstrate that all the life and all the beauty of our city are connected with the water.
But time to time, the water turns out to be an enemy.
From its foundation in 1703, St. Petersburg has been suffering for centuries because of several floods. The most disastrous was the one in 1824, when the water level exceeded 4 meters and 20 centimeters, marked off the mean level of the Baltic Sea. Up to 600 people were killed and more than 3,000 houses were destroyed. In 1924, the water level was as high as 3 meters and 80 centimeters. Most part of city communications were cut off. 20 bridges and over 5,000 buildings were destroyed. Total damage ran into hundreds of millions of rubles. The main reason of the Leningrad floods is the storm surge in the Neva Bay. Coming from the northern Atlantic, atmospheric cyclone creates in the Baltic Sea the so-called long wave. Such wave is formed both by static effect due to low atmospheric pressure in the center of cyclone, which really sucks the water up, and by dynamic effect due to combined action of wind and currents. In the open sea, height of the wave doesn't exceed 30-50 centimeters. But when the wave comes to narrow and shallow eastern part of the Gulf of Finland, and especially into the Neva Bay, its height increases dramatically. Overflowing the Neva River banks, water spreads through streets and squares of the city. Under such conditions, up to 120,000 cubic meters of the water flow each second into the Neva Bay from the west, comparing to 2,500 cubic meters discharging by the Neva River.
On this satellite picture, we can see the main features of the project to protect Leningrad against floods, which is being under realization now. The protective structure has 25 kilometers in length. Strictly speaking, this structure is not a dam. It consists of 11 dams separated by 6 water gates and 2 ship gates. The highway along reach of the structure will be positioned 6.5 meters above the mean level of the Baltic Sea and will be protected from the west side by additional shield of 1.5 meters in height.
Dams are made of earth and stones and have various lengths, from over 1 kilometer and up to 3 kilometers. Each of the water gates is nearly 300 meters wide and may be closed in 30 minutes under the threat of the flood. Ship gates are under construction now. Southern ship gate will be 200 meters wide and capable to pass across ships with displacement up to 100,000 tons all the year round. The northern ship gate with 100 meters length will be used only during warm seasons for ships under 4,000 tons. integral cross-section of 8 gates is 9,600 square meters, or 150% of cross-section of all the Neva River mouth. It is quite natural to suppose that a lot of geoecological problems could be arisen by such large-scale intervention into environment. For example, the public opinion both in Leningrad and in Finland had expected that the dam effect increases pollution of the Neva Bay and decreases the one of the Gulf of Finland. But through field studies and as a result of modeling efforts, it became almost certain that protective structures do not detain the water at all, only slightly slows down the water exchange and are practically transparent for dissolved substances. Unfortunately, we still have no knowledge enough to estimate and to predict possible changes in dispersion and distribution of particulates due to the dam effect, as well as the related pollution problems. This is a field of future research.
So, Victor, do you believe that this dam is going to be completed?
Now it's this construction complete approximately about 80%. Mm. And I think it must be complete. Yes. But in general, public opinion against this construction. But I think, and we will try to show with this our video, that the environmental impact of this construction are very local, really
it's
local.
Only local. It's nothing that we need to be concerned about in Sweden or in Poland. Or
I think
it's only for the St. Petersburg area.
I think so.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's rather better for us, perhaps. You keep your pollutants back up there. Okay, then let's look at the other large technical project that we are facing here in the Baltic region, and that is, of course, the large bridges that are being planned or even built in between Denmark and Sweden and within Denmark. And I think we will see some of that if we go back to our model. So if we please could find the picture of the model there. Yes, I think we have the two red small pieces there will symbolize the bridges. And will you all say where they are?
Yes, sir. We have one between Skåne and Själland, between Sweden and Denmark, that is, and one between the two Danish islands where you have the main inflow of blue water in this model.
And the question is, of course, if these bridges will somehow make the inflow of salt water more difficult. Do you think we could have an opinion on that, Lars?
Well, I think that we really need an environmental consequence analysis, a real environmental consequence analysis. But to do that type of analysis, you need solid empirical data on the water exchange, the salt exchange, and the bottom dynamic conditions. Mm-hmm. And today, it is my belief that we lack such data. And that means that we only have room for rather freewheeling speculations about drawbacks and benefits of that bridge.
So referring back to the student question on modeling, perhaps we could say that models are not only the sole important factor, also the data are quite important.
Well, of course, I mean, you need the empirical data to validate the models.
Now, so if we can't say that this bridge construction perhaps is the largest threat against the Baltic Sea, if that's your conclusion or...
Well, I would say that the bridge may be a problem, but we already face very severe problems. Mm. We have severe problems with eutrophication, and we have considerable problems with toxic substances like chlorinated organic substances. Mm. And we also know that the pollutants from the River Rhine are transported to the Skagerrak, Kattegat, and into the Baltic. And in the future, the deep salt water may not be as oxygenated.
Mm-hmm.
And that may be a very considerable threat. So I think it's very important to make these environmental consequence analyses, because if you do that, you can distinguish between big and small problems and between real and imaginary problems.
Thank you, Lars. I think these words were very fitting as a final comment on the task we had ahead of us, and we will talk about all these in future sessions in the Baltic University. Now I would like to say thank you to all the participants here, to Ulf Erlingsson from Uppsala, to Viktor Jonov from St. Petersburg, to Andrzej Kowalczewski from Warszawa, and we are very happy that you were able to come here all the way from your countries. And with these words also, we would like to ask Lena Kautsky, who is coordinator of the next session, to say a few words.
Yes, the next session will discuss life in the Baltic Sea, and that will take part on the 6th of November, and we'll concentrate on how plants and animals have been able to adapt to the low salinity of the Baltic, because it's been a very short time that they have had for that adaptation.
Thank you, Lena. If you are back with us in 2 weeks' time, you will hear more about that. But we are through for this particular time, and thank you all who have watched this and who has listened to us, and welcome back.